Hello friends, this is the 19th lesson in the series Julius Caesar, the real versus Shakespeare's Caesar. So we're going to find out the differences and the similarities between the real Caesar, the one who actually existed in Rome, and Shakespeare's interpretation of who Caesar was. This is presented by me, Palak Sharma. Few things about me: I'm an economics honors student, a poet at heart, a theater geek, a mixture of Keynes and Shakespeare. And you know what you have to do once you're done watching this lesson? You have to rate, review, recommend, and share this lesson as much as you can. And you can follow me on Unacademy. Here's my link. Now, Shakespeare is notorious. He's notorious for pliable history, that which he can bend, he can stretch, he can mold, and he can work into any shape which pleases him and which helps him make a dramatic point. So, and if you're not inclined, a political point also. So we see that the real Caesar, who he was. Now we see that the real Caesar, his name was Gaius Julius Caesar. His birthday was 2 or 3 days before the IDs of July in 100 BC. Caesar's real father died when he was 16. 2 years later, at the age of 18, Caesar married Cornelia, the daughter of a noble, and had their only legitimate child, Julia. Okay, so we see that this was the real Caesar. Now, Shakespeare's Caesar. It is clear that Shakespeare's Caesar, he based his play almost exclusively on Plutarch's narrative of Roman character. So there was this historian Plutarch in Rome, and on his interpretation, Shakespeare wrote Julius Caesar, the tragedy of Julius Caesar. His play was then translated into English by Thomas North in 1579. Actually, the play, I'm sorry, it was Plutarch's narrative, which was translated from Roman language to English by Thomas North in 1579. The text was popular. Plutarch's text, it was very popular one, and Shakespeare had access to it, of course. So he just took some parts from Plutarch's narrative of Roman characters. We see that Caesar died on the IDs of March in both the play and also in the real life. But it is not confirmed whether he was actually warned beforehand about his death by a soothsayer, as we see in the play, who comes in the first act and announces that beware of the IDs of the march. So we do not have any evidences that in reality also, was Caesar really warned like this by the soothsayer or not? Though this is a difference. Then we see that in this play, act first, in scene 2, Antony offers Caesar the crown thrice and Caesar refused that he doesn't want it. But in Caesar's actual history, Antony offers him a diadem, the symbol of Hellenistic monarchs, which looks something like this. But Caesar refuses it, saying that the only king of Romans is Jupiter, not Caesar. So now we have certain evidence that actually Caesar refused the crown, but it was not the crown which was refused for. It was a diadem, something like this, which they wear on their heads. This was a symbol of Hellenistic monarchs. So he said that it was not Caesar, it was Jupiter who was the ruler of Romans. So he couldn't take the title of the god himself. So then we also see that this play opens with a combination of Caesar's triumph and the Feast of Lupercal also. So there's Caesar coming after defeating Pompey, and there's the Feast of Lupercal going on. But in reality, these were two events which were separated by many months. Caesar had returned to Rome in September, okay, in 45 BC, I guess, and the triumphs were held shortly thereafter, right? So if you've come, there'll be triumph right then. But Lupercalia, it takes place between 13th and 15th of February. So you see, there's a difference of like around 6 months difference. That we see that since September, they have not celebrated the triumphs or what? They're celebrating the triumphs on Lupercal, that is February. This is again not true because there's a lot of time lag between the two. So the play gives the impression that the assassination, the funeral oration, the will reading, and the arrival of Octavius, they all take place on the same day. But in reality, the assassination took place on the IDs of March, which we know, which is March 15th. Then we know the will was read 3 days later after the assassination, and the funeral took place after around 2 days. Okay, and Octavius, he didn't arrive in Rome until May. So this is again like very confusing but dramatic in itself, that after the death of Cassius, Brutus says that yet ere night we shall try fortune in second fight. So in reality, the second and the climactic battle of Philippi took place almost 3 weeks after the first. It was not the next day itself, like in the play. So all of these, they push the play, pace of the play, the speed of the play, and they drive the momentum of the piece, as we can see. We can also see that there are two other changes to history that Shakespeare makes that have nothing to do with spacing or pacing and speeding, however. In this play, the assassination takes place at the Capitol, and that's a pretty dramatic setting. But however, in reality, if anything, it was even more symbolic. Caesar was killed at the Curia of Pompey, which we can see a meeting hall at the theater of Pompey. And given the past conflict between Caesar and Pompey and the personal history that many of the conspirators had with the late Pompey the Great, it's a fitting locale that it was the right situation to kill Caesar. But of course, Shakespeare gets it to play like gets to play both way a little. He just happens to have a statue of Pompey at the Capitol, and he just says at the base of this Capitol's building and Pompey's statue, Caesar's dead body lay. So this is, we have a very strategic location of Caesar's assassination in the play versus the reality in which it just happened below the statue of Pompey without any show and without any presence of the building of Capitol. So finally, we have another issue, which is the issue of last words. He said, "Et tu, Brute, then falls Caesar," which is, I guess, Act 3 and line 76 or so. But there's no historical basis for this. The Roman historian by the name of Suetonius, he says these were some unsubstantiated reports, and they said that Caesar was saying, "And you, child." So the Latin and its adonym aren't all Shakespeare's either. So the words, they were a part of the Elizabethan play. It was some other Elizabethan play that Caesar wrote, and he just pilfered and he just added the "Et tu, Brute" part to this play. So this emotion of deceiving, it was part of some other play of Shakespeare, and he just added its effect on Julius Caesar so that it could make the play more dramatic, more tragic. So this was all. This was real versus the Shakespearean tragedy of Julius Caesar. You've seen that how Shakespeare was different, how Shakespearean Caesar was different from the real Caesar. You can also see here some points where the play was different from the actual reality, what happened in Rome during the assassination of Caesar, the lag of times, the killing, the situation, the backdrop, everything. So this is it. The next lesson will be the last lesson, and we'll be covering the major themes, the entire themes of the play. This is it. Rate, review, recommend, and share the lessons. Have a nice day.